Hi there, everybody. Hope you're doing marvellously well. It's Warren Huart here with the great Tony Franklin. How are you, mate?
Hi, Warren. I'm doing great. Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. So Tony's here. You're here to create some rock and roll history.
All of the above.
All of the above. It's great that you've been doing some charts here. And look at that. Well, tell me about this bass.
This was my first real bass.
Really? You have your first real bass?
This is the first real bass. Being a Fender Precision bass. I actually had a bass before this, a Futurama.
Oh, I remember the Futurama.
Remember, it was a red thing, and it was actually kind of based on a Precision bass. Had those awful black nylon taper strings,
right.
All those things where I cut my fingers to pieces. I didn't know that there was anything else. It actually belonged to my mum, that bass.
Your mum played bass?
Yeah.
That's a
whole story unto itself. We could fill the whole... Real,
is your mum Carol Kay?
No, she's not.
In Derby County. Carol Kay used to live in... No. It's the whole room.
But once my parents saw that I was very... Actually, bass came to me. It was one of those instruments that just... I've been playing music. I'd be about 12 years old at this point. Was very bored. And I'd been playing music for quite a while. I could read music. I've been playing gigs with my parents' band for... 7 years at that point, since age 5. But
that's
different
amazing.
Instruments.
Oh, wow.
And then they were doing a rehearsal with their band, and I was not in on it. And I was very bored and making a pest of myself. So this red Futurama bass kind of appeared from nowhere. It was like, this thing appeared. And my mum gave it to me and said, here. Try this, see if you like it.
I think what I'm getting is this picture of your parents' band needs a bass player.
That wasn't the thought at the time.
Oh, okay.
It was just to keep me quiet and stop being a nuisance. But
Right. Who
knows? But the moment this thing, it was like, this thing literally, I instantly had a feeling, a sense of what the bass was all about and how to play it.
Right.
My mum showed me the names of the strings, where I'd put my hands. 3 days later, I was playing gigs with them on the bass.
Wow.
And so it was just one, because I knew how to read music, and so it happened very, very quickly. So anyway, a year or so after that, they knew I was very serious about it, time to get a real bass. My dad saw an ad in the paper, the Derby Evening Telegraph, and somebody
was... Do you mind me asking what year this is?
This was be 76.
76?
Yeah. Possibly... Yeah, be early 76, because I knew I wanted a Fender Precision bass because John Deacon from Queen played one, right?
Oh, yeah.
My dad had been talking about the Fender Precision bass. He was a keyboard player, but he knew that a Fender Precision bass was really the only bass that you should have. And he was right in that regard.
Especially in those days.
Well, exactly. Yeah. I mean, you look at album sleeves in those days... Mm-hmm. Players, actually in the 60s, they aren't even listed as playing bass, they're listed as playing Fender bass.
Oh, wow.
So it was the distinction between the acoustic bass, the upright bass, and a Fender bass. Because the Fender Precision bass, which was so named, do you know this story?
No.
The Precision bass was called that way because it was the first time they were trying to attract the upright players to play. Transitioning to the modern sound where they could keep up with the amplified guitars and the loud drums. Mm-hmm. But for the first time, they had the frets so they could play precisely.
Oh, well, makes perfect sense.
As simple as that, the precision bass. And so anyway, we went over to this lady's house somewhere in the outskirts of Derby, and I remember looking at this thing. It was originally white, Olympic white. And
this is in 76.
This is in 76, yes. And it was pretty much in mint condition. And she apparently was selling it because she couldn't play it because her nails were too long. And even at my age, at 14 at that point, I'm thinking, I'm not going to tell her that she could cut her nails. Because this bass was like speaking to me. And so my parents made a deal and that was it. I paid my parents back. And
how much did you pay?
I think it was £275.
Well, it's actually quite a lot of money in those
days. Quite a lot of money, yeah. So, but hey, it was, seriously, it was like holding a holy relic. It's a fairly light bass, and it just felt right. It still does.
Oh, yeah, that's light.
It is.
Yeah, it's very light.
And for a precision bass, the neck is pretty narrow up here as well. I don't know if you can see that, but it's pretty narrow. Just I think the 70s basses, this is a 76.
And so it was like brand new.
It was pretty much new, yeah. She had the thing and decided it wasn't for her.
Fantastic.
So that was it.
Fantastic for you.
Yeah, absolutely. And so at some point when I heard Jaco Pastorius, I knew that I needed a fretless bass, which is another story coming up. But I was
that
like...
That first Jaco album.
Oh, that was it. That was the moment. It's like, the bass can really do this. That's right. It doesn't sound the same on a fretless, on a fret bass. Come on, come over. So, but anyway, after hearing that, it's like, how does he get all those harmonics? It doesn't really work on the... Actually, I can... For some reason, I can do it a little bit more now, maybe because I'm playing so hard, but... All those harmonics that he was getting don't jump out so much with just the P bass. And it's like, oh, I looked at his bass, which was a jazz bass. He's got the extra pickup. So wow. I thought, that's what I need. Put that in. So that gave me the flexibility. So I went and got a DiMarzio pickup.
Is that what that is, a DiMarzio?
That's DiMarzio. It's the original one. Why did I choose a DiMarzio? Because I saw on the back of a Kiss album that they used DiMarzio pickups. So my reasoning was, they must be loud.
There's Ace with his three DiMarzios.
Exactly. So I figured, I reasoned they must be loud. So I went
and
went in and asked for the loudest DiMarzio pickup that they had.
This is in Derby?
This is in my local Derby music shop.
Right.
And so they gave me this one. And the beauty of that is that the output of the two, because the P bass and a regular jazz bass pickup, they're... The P bass is a lot louder.
Right.
So these match perfectly. So
very smart.
I put in a three-way Strat switch.
Did you wire it yourself?
I did. With a hammer and chisel, soldering iron, and that was pretty much it, a saw. And you can see I really messed it up there, but it doesn't matter. All kind of adds to the...
I was about to say, it gives it character.
It does. So, yeah, I did it myself.
Is this the original bridge?
It's the original bridge, yes.
Oh, fantastic.
So everything is original about it, so...
And she probably played it twice because of her fingernails.
That's right.
So you're pretty much the only person who's ever played this bass.
Mm-hmm.
These are all your marks.
These are all mine. And I stripped it down because the Olympic white was just flaking off. It was like, I don't know what was going on with it, bad finish or something. So I stripped it down, put a couple of coats of varnish that were in my dad's shed. And that's
I love it. I built my first guitar with my dad.
Wow.
Because of exactly the same logic as a guitar player.
Right.
I wanted to be Brian May.
Brian May, the Red Special.
Yeah. I just wanted to do the same thing. For us, Queen was like the band.
It really was, yeah. I mean, I was a member of the Queen fan club.
So was I.
There you go.
Yeah.
Who was it? Sue? Pam and Sue? Was it Pat and Sue, the two?
Oh, you remember better than me.
Yeah. I remember all their middle names, their star signs, and even the drummer's, Roger Taylor's tech.
Wow.
Chris Taylor, whose nickname was Crystal, and one time...
Crystal.
They were playing a gig, and they'd all done it. It was at Staffordshire Bingley Hall.
Right.
And everybody was leaving, and I went up to the front of the stage, the band had done and everything, and I shouted, Crystal! And Cossie's like, who's that? I said, can you throw me a drumstick? So he threw me one of Roger Taylor's drumsticks.
Do you still have it?
Yeah.
Oh.
1976, they were playing Day at the Races and all the old stuff, Ogre Battle and all that stuff. It was magic.
Seven Seas of Rye. And
yeah, exactly. That's what they started the show with, yeah.
The start with Tie Your Mother Down?
Mm-hmm. With the tape music, you know, the start of Day of the Races.
Yeah.
Oh, getting chills thinking about it.
Brian's guitar playing on that is insane.
Everything. I mean, the songwriting and the diversity. You go from Death on Two Legs to Lazin' on a Sunday Afternoon. Yeah. It's like you got this real snarky, heavy opening thing and then goes into like a 40s, barbershop thing. Yeah. It's
all done,
amazing.
All the horn sections done on guitars.
Mm-hmm.
Crazy.
I know.
And you remember on the back of the albums, it always said, no synthesizers.
And I was really let down when The Game came out and said, for the first time we used synthesizers.
Although, The Game, for me, is one of my favorite albums.
It's a good album,
It's insane how good the album is.
It is, yeah. And but I, at the time, I remember being like, no.
But you're like, Freddie's cut his hair short and they're using synthesizers. What's going on?
So I'm ready to play some music.
Let's play some music. Yeah, yeah. Let's do this track. Thanks. I sent you some MP3s and you chired them out. Thank you.
Yes. Well, you know, I like to be prepared. It's like, write out a pretty detailed chart, but at the same time, it's just a guide. You know, because it's not like something set in stone. I like to flow with it and see and get all input. I follow my own gut, but listen to what everybody has to say about it and see what needs to be done. But preparation for me is very important. It just saves time and makes it easier. And say, oh, what's next? So
for you, you know, doing sessions, you've got to come in. You may have an hour.
Yeah, exactly. And I like to get it done. You know, yeah. I think there's something to be said about, an early take where you got the energy and the flow as well. And so if it's like, oh, it's going great. Oh, what's next? Oh, it's like, it kind of blows that. But
I hear you.
Can you give me a little bit more overall?
Yep.
Don't want to kill you all, but.
Oh, it's not like that.
Yeah, I know. Gotta feel it, you know?
Yeah. Nice. Got the retard there, great.
I was looking for it. Ah, that's what I saw. I saw the guitar hit.
Well, when we cut the guitars, we did it at Sunset Sound, and of course, you know, Van Halen 1 and 2 was done there, and we put his guitar through the chamber. So
nice.
when he plugged in, I went play da na 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 na, because you know you hear Eddie going da na 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 na.
Yeah.
So that's why he kept playing You Really Got Me, because he wanted that.
That's funny.
That was fantastic.
Cool.
That was great, yeah. I really want to hear the fretless on it, because this is probably the groove song that you can you can slide up and down on and have some fun with. But that was great. I mean, that will...
Got that, so...
We got it. Now let's have some fun with Fretless. Maybe a little bit more?
Yeah.
You got amazing intonation on that thing.
You got to if you're going to play fretless,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
People say that, I mean, thankfully, it's one of those things that people say to me quite a lot, but to me, it's like,
right,
if you're going to play it,
yeah,
have it be in tune, right? Because it's like, you know, it's still the bass. People shouldn't be, the bass plays a role.
Yeah.
You know, it's to hold down the low end and hold down the groove.
Sure. Absolutely.
And, you know, if it's whatever it is that's achieving that, then if it's doing that, then the job's done. Be it fretless, fretted, be it a stick, it's still got their job to do.
Have you played one of those Chapman stick things?
I did, but I thought, you know, if I'm going to really apply myself to this, it's like a whole study in itself.
Sure.
If I'm going to get good at it, then...
I saw Crimson, I think, mid-90s with Trey, Gunn, and Tony Levin.
Oh, wow.
You remember that? So
yes.
Trey was on the stick. And Tony was playing like three-string bass. He had like a three-string Music Man and a five and a four and a, yeah.
Yeah.
Here we go. All right, here we go.
I got a spacey moment. Can we go back just to that, whatever
minor.
You call that? I'm calling it the C section, the C sharp minor, yeah.
Nice. Fantastic. Good luck. That was fantastic. I mean, all I'd want you to do is do one more where you just go completely over the top.
Okay.
Just give me like the, you know, I often say this to singers, it's the same thing. It's like with a singer, you have to give the great in time, in tune, over. Now, because it might just cherry pick.
Yeah, get some fills or whatever.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
You know, especially because it's a fretless and you can just get those whams.
Yeah, that
we can never do on a fretted. It's remarkable. I mean, I assume you spend 99% of your life on the fretless. It's like...
Pretty much,
You can make this... You can make this be a fretted when you want.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I delight in that.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And you have the drop D tuner there as well?
Yes, I do, yeah. And, you know, I dig in with the pick as well, so it's like
Great.
That...
Best of all worlds.
It is, it really is. And just the... You know, you have the real kind of Jaco. You can do all that kind of stuff. Got all that kind of stuff. But then, dig out and get a pick out of my pocket. Oh, I don't have a pick. Oh, I thought of Brian May because I have a quarter, but it would be a sixpence with him, wouldn't it?
I don't know if you have a preference.
I like a... Oh, that one will probably do it. A Tortex right there. So you can really...
Yeah.
So you can really do...
Yeah.
Make it sound like a P bass. Which after all, it is.
Right.
Still, you know,
that's
still,
fantastic. Yeah.
And you don't know that it's a fretless bass.
Until you want it to be.
Until you want it to be, then you do a little.
Yeah. Wow, that's fantastic.
I love it.
Let's do one more take and then I'm going to ask you about it. I only want to keep you in the zone.
I try to aspire to always be in the zone. But...
No, I'm sure you will be. I want to ask you a million questions about it, but we'll get one more take and then I'll ask you some stuff.
Same C sharp section. Actually, the section before that, if you can. Just like four measures before that. Yeah.
Hey, can you try one thing while you're here?
Yes.
So when it's. There's a guitar going. Can we try
do
this?
Do an offbeat kind of thing?
Yeah, so like a. Drive on the eights. Yeah. Just one section like that, just so we have it as a variation.
Yeah. I mean, throughout the pretty much the whole section.
Just try it. Yeah. Just catch. So it's catching both the guitars.
Yeah. Okay.
There you go. Fantastic.
I know which ones are the drums, though. Right there.
Yeah! AG, was it AG?
I did the wrong note, didn't I?
No. You do whatever you like, nobody else. That was fantastic.
Great cool. work. Yeah, a few little extra things in there.
The little offbeat stuff was great. There was loads of little lead bits in there that we can drop in.
Yeah.
Love so it. You can, so tell me about the fretless.
The
tell
fretless. Us well, the fretless first, and you, if you notice, they're pretty much replicas of each other.
Right.
Purely by, well, just a decision to stay on the precision was a very conscious one, because I don't even own a jazz bass. I just love the feel and the feel of the neck and the sound and everything about the precision bass, especially with these pickups. But having that, the DiMarzio jazz bass pickup in there gives me just all the tonal flexibility. I like having a master volume, a master tone. I don't like having individual ones, because it's clean, it's simple. It is yeah. what it is. You have the selector switch. So I have exactly the same in both basses. That one came first, and then when Jaco came along, heard his solo album, mind blown, knew I had to have a fretless bass.
Donnelly?
So, what's that?
Did you ever learn Donnelly?
He's
like, don't throw me under the bus.
You know, I quickly realized that there's no way that I can even come close to that. So I really didn't try to.
Right.
But what I took from Jaco was his, I saw him really as a rock player. Mm-hmm. You see him live, he's got overdrive and he sure. has the presence of a rock star. He's jumping around and he owns the audience. He's throwing his bass around and everything. I mean, it's like he's the total rock star. He's really, but the jazz guys say, well, he's a jazz guy. No, he's, belongs to both. He really does.
He does. He's the Jimi Hendrix of bass.
He really is, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I took his aggressive approach to the bass, but I also took his groove. I mean, that's the thing. You know, the thing that people have to realize for bass players, I find complete freedom and flexibility on the fretless. And I love it because it can still play the role of a fretted bass. As I was, you just need to hold it down. You'd never know it was a fretless bass.
Yeah, absolutely.
Until you decide to use something. And people hit, well, what was that? That's yeah. not, and it's like, oh, wow. But I don't use it. A lot of people I find view the fretless bass almost like it's an effect pedal or a novelty.
Sure.
And you can, sure, you can do it. You can do all that stuff and it's cool. Do all the harmonics too. That's yeah. a whole other thing. But I don't treat it like that. I see it as being a bass instrument. It's still the bass, be it fretted or fretless. But I love the ability to be able to express and do those little almost vocal mm-hmm. things, because a voice doesn't have frets. We're very free with it. It's so,
absolutely. Yeah.
So if we want to get excited, we want to go up and down or bend it up and down, we do that. We don't think about it. We don't think, oh, I've got these ridges in my voice that stop me from doing
sure.
that. So I view and think of the fretless as that, as having that ultimate freedom, really, without, but we don't. Just because we've got a voice without frets, we don't go, ooh, all the time, unless you're Ken Dodd or something. But
see if anybody remembers who Ken's Dodd, well, in America, I have no idea.
They'll have no clue. Yeah. Ken Dodd and the Diddy Man, yes.
And Sooty.
And Sooty and Sweet. Sooty and Sweet. We are definitely showing our age now.
Yes.
But it's not to be overused, but it's just one of those just beautiful things mm-hmm. about it. So, but anyway, this, people say, well, your intonation is good. To me, it's still the bass and it's got to be good. It has to be good if you're going to get on the fretless bass and hold down the band, because I was saying earlier that the job of the bass is to maintain the groove and to hold down the low end. And actually, two lessons that came to me very early on in my career. It was my first professional gig. I was 18 years old. I was playing at the Birmingham Edgbaston Mecca Ballroom. with a 10-piece band called Pete's People.
Pete's People?
Pete's People.
As opposed to Pan's People, for more English people.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Definitely showing a raise there. Sorry, I sidetracked thinking about Pan's People.
Yeah, there was some... Yeah, anyway, look up Pan's People, Top of the Pops.
So, first professional gig about 2 months into that, you know, it was a 10-piece dance band, so we're playing a lot of ballroom dancing and a lot of current music and kind of everything between 40s, 50s to early 80s stuff, a lot of disco stuff. And it was very, very charted, very scripted. The parts were very defined what we were to play. But here's me, got my first professional gig, getting comfortable, and started to stretch out a little bit. You know how it is, you get that first, you start to get a little busy. Now, about 2 months into it, the leader, Pete, said to me, "Hey, listen, if you don't quieten it down a little bit with your playing and keep it to the parts, I might have to let you go."
Oh, wow.
And I'm like, oh, okay. I got that right away. He went straight back to what was on the music and kept it at that. Big lesson there, because a lot of the time, especially coming in for sessions, it's our job to play what's right for the song. It's not what's right to play for us sometimes, or our egos sometimes. Mm-hmm. We gotta, usually, especially for bass, is to keep it simple.
Yeah.
You know, and there are times, and knowing when to not keep to that, when to stretch it and do your fills and do all that stuff. But most of the time, you gotta keep it really simple. So there, and then a month or so after that, the drummer turned around to me and said, "Hey, you know it's not only the drummer's job to keep time."
Ooh.
And that was like, okay, right there. It's two big lessons right there, which to me are the foundation of bass playing and all musicians. You know, you gotta do what's right for the gig, which means sometimes keeping it simple, and also have your own sense of time, have your own sense of meter. Because bass players, to me, play a crucial role in the band. People say, well, do you play to the kick drum? Do you play with the drums? Well, yes, but no, because you're playing with a whole band. And if you, for instance, quite often you play in a situation where, I've been very fortunate to play with a lot of players who have excellent timing in their own right, but sometimes you play in a situation where, for instance, the drummer is right down the middle holding it on time, but the guitarist may be pushing. Mm-hmm. Or one of the members may be pushing. So what do you do?
What guitar players do. To play in front of everybody else.
Yeah, I don't know why it is. It's just one of those things. I mean, some of the greatest players in the world do that.
Listen to those first two Van Halen albums.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It always feels like it's like...
So,
but it makes it exciting.
It does. It gives it an edge. It gives it an excitement. But if I was to play solely with the drums, then it would probably make the guitar feel way in front. Mm-hmm. If I was to play solely with the guitar, it would probably make the drums feel like they're lagging.
Yeah.
So I find that sweet little spot in the middle of all that, which glues it all together. The bass is the glue that holds it all together. But, you know, if I'm like, oh, am I following his time or that time? No, you've got to have your own strong sense of meter and time.
Sure.
So you're holding it down and finding that the glue that holds it all together. While listening to everything else, the vocals, the melodies, you've got to be conscious of it all. I love the bass because it's one of the only instruments, other than the voice and lead instruments, that have a single note. Mm-hmm. The rest of them are polyphonic.
Sure.
And so it's like a lead instrument in itself. But, you know,
I don't know. Wonderful.
But not lead bass, can't play lead bass.
I'm sure you can. Look, so tell me that. Thanks for all that. Was fantastic. Tell me a bit about this bass in particular. When did you get it?
This I got once again. My dad saw it in the Melody Maker, actually.
Ah, classifieds in the back.
Yes. Advertise in the bass center.
Did you ever get any gigs from?
No.
Oh, you didn't.
I think I might have applied for a cruise. Maybe that was in there.
The back of the Melody Maker.
Yeah.
I went to auditions, but I never got the gigs. I auditioned with Generation X guys after Billy Idol left. That's a whole other off-camera story. Anyway, carry on.
My dad, once again, saw an ad in the Melody Maker for a fretless precision bass. Now, Fender only made the fretless...
What year?
This is a 77.
So it's just a year later.
Mm-hmm. Well, the bass is from them, but I actually got this in like 78, possibly 79.
78, 79.
So, okay. But this is a 77 P bass. I knew that I wanted the unlined. I don't know why I wanted the unlined.
Yeah. Because you wanted to make it hard for yourself.
There's just something that, I don't know, it just...
Purist? Or just look?
Well, maybe it was fated to be because I knew I wanted a precision bass. Mm-hmm. Didn't like the jazz, I didn't like the feel of it, didn't like the skinny neck, I didn't like the sound of the pickups, I didn't like the offset body. Those are all the things that jazz players love about the bass.
Yeah.
I love the precision bass because it wasn't any of those things.
It's kind of tougher feeling.
It is, and it just sits right with me. It's just right. So, you know, it's a personal thing.
Absolutely.
But the precision is my thing. And so at that point, Fender only offered the unlined.
Ah.
It wasn't until, ironically, Jaco Pastorius came along that everybody wanted a lined jazz bass. So pretty much the fretless precision went away.
Oh, I see.
So once the end of the 70s and mid to late 70s, these had gone away. So it was like, I got it in that era. So it was just
one
of those.
And you said he got it from the Bass Center?
I got it at the Bass Center in London. And they had a maple neck one and the rosewood one. And I knew I wanted the rosewood just for the for the durability. And
just the feel.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I actually played an unlined precision with a maple neck and it had a coating on it and it just felt, I don't know, it just felt...
Sticky.
Yeah, not right. Yeah. It just wasn't right. So this is the one that they had and I remember picking it up and it's like, this is not a friendly instrument to play, this one especially. You have to fight it. Mm-hmm. And I actually like that because it gets a bit more of an edge and a bit more of emotion out of it. I like instruments that Fenders and Gibsons tend to be a little bit more of a fight to get a sound. And I mean, some guitars, especially the new ones that are set up with a real low action.
Right, the shredding guitars.
The shredding guitars. And hey, every respect to that, sure. Because some of those players are just simply astounding what they
Incredible,
do.
Incredible, yeah.
But the instrument is almost the action, you barely have to touch it. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, when you hear like Jimmy Page and a lot of the old blues guys play, mm-hmm. that you can really, and Stevie Ray Vaughan, I mean, they have those heavy strings.
Oh, yeah, like a... telephone wires.
Exactly. Yeah. And so he had to really work it. And so it's like it brings an emotion. It brings a pain.
Funnily enough, Brian used to use like sevens and eights.
Right. Real light. Yeah, and using the sixpence too. So it would be a very...
strings like every second.
Yeah, I know. A real light action. But that's how he got his tone as well.
Yeah. Best guitar tone ever.
So. And so sometimes I will play real light on this and play... over the fingerboard. And it gets a real singy tone as opposed to... It's very punchy.
Very Jaco, yeah.
Yeah, so Jaco was all down here.
Great.
And then you, with the same pickup configuration, you play right over here. Very melodic and makes you romantic and stuff.
What was it like your next transition to like, because you must have been pretty damn young when you were in the firm then.
I was 22 when we were touring. We'd already done the album by then. So yeah, right. I was really young. But I just...
So 18 to 22, what was going on there?
Pete's People.
Pete's People. Right, yes. Up to that gig?
I did that up until I was about 2021, and then Roy Harper he was doing another album, did a couple of albums with him, and then there was...
How did you meet Roy Harper?
It was actually through the drummer in Pete's People.
Wow.
He worked in a music shop in Hereford called Buzz Music. Do you remember that place? They would always advertise in there.
I probably saw the logo. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. But George Jackson was the drummer in Pete's People. And... it's funny how things work out, isn't it? But the manager of Buzz Music, where George worked, mm-hmm. he went on to manage Roy Harper. And Roy Harper was putting a session together.
Wow.
And so Mark Thompson, the manager, was putting the band together to do that. They called in George to do it, and from Pete's people, and they said, do you know a bass player? And so, Tony's pretty good, so.
That's fantastic. What a transition. Pete's people, Roy Harper.
Well, there was a disco band in between that called the Night Catchers.
The Night Catchers.
And we actually made an appearance on Peter Powell's The Oxford Road Show. Remember that?
Of course. Wow.
I'm trying to find it on YouTube, but it's not on there.
It's going to be there somewhere. We're going to find somebody that works at the BBC that can go through the videotapes and find it.
It was like a cross between Duran Duran and Almost Human League, one of those kind of things.
So lots of synths being played with two fingers.
Yeah, there was that. But there was some slap bass as well. It was all on not on the fretless, but I was doing You can slap on that. You can slap on a fretless. People ask me if you can slap on a fretless, and you sure can. And you can do a lot of other stuff too. I'm not doing it too well. All that kind of stuff, you know. So it takes it to another place. But there was a lot of that, and so it was I'd got into Mark King a little bit at that point too.
He used to work at the Bass Centre.
There you go. Yeah. All these circles. England and the music scene is a very small world. It really is. But and I was also with a band called Tall Story, which was like, you won't have heard of them. No. They opened for Roy Harper, and that's how that connected. I went off and played with them for a while. So, you know, Pete's People went on for a couple of years, and then I kind of...
Isn't it great to, like, play classic songs and covers?
It really is.
It develops your ear.
It really does,
I had the same experience for a couple of years. I lived in the north of England in Carlisle, and I just toured working men's clubs, and just did all those shows.
That is some training right there. Yeah, with my parents' band, I played Grimsby and Cleethorpes Fisherman's Club.
Nice, Fisherman's Club. That's sophisticated.
Oh, not really. And I play on the clarinet, I would play a version of Ackerbilk Stranger on the Shore.
Oh. Course.
And so
number one single in England.
Yeah, exactly. Another one to look up on YouTube. Acker Bilk.
That's A-C-K-E-R.
B-I-L-K. Yeah. But it's a funny story going on from there, how I made that connection with the firm, because it was through Roy Harper. Mm-hmm. He was doing an album, brought Jimmy in to play on it too, and we were just cutting an album together. It was very relaxed.
Great.
It was, and so it just, everything led on from there. They asked me if I wanted to sit in on the rehearsals for the new band. I wasn't actually asked to be in the band.
Was there a bass player you were replacing?
They'd had different players come and sit in. I heard that Pino Palladino had done it. Now, I knew that Pino I knew him as a fretless player. That's all I knew him as, because he'd done a lot of those sessions, you know,
Paul Young
and I remember Wherever You Lay Your Hat and that intro.
Baldy
ball.
Yeah.
And it had that harmonic.
Oh, yeah. That baldy ball. I mean, that was synonymous for fretless.
Exactly. It was iconic. I remember it to this day. And so I thought, wow, they had Pino in. They must like the fretless. So that was the only bass I took. It was this bass.
And had he been playing fretless with them?
I don't know.
Oh.
The discussion never came up. And but I told Pino the story afterwards, and he got a kick from it. But that's the only bass I took. There was no discussion whether, you know, it's not really working. It just was what I played. That's what I brought. And, right.
And very contemporary in those days. So you know, that was like...
I suppose so. I didn't even think of it. Once again, it was the bass, and it had.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess in hindsight, it was kind of a little.
It gave him a
bold,
twist.
A little bold, almost. Yeah. But I didn't think of it in that way. Mm-hmm. It's just like, this is what I want to do, and it felt like it was right. And then we ended up. I remember there was one day. They said, "Do you want to play a cover?" And so.
What was the cover?
It was "You Lost That Love and Feeling."
Oh wow.
And so I came up with this bass line. It's for the middle section, which they end up liking. It was this. Oh, let me do it again in tune. So it kind of covered a lot. It kind of covered the bass line, and it covered like the chords and everything And Jimmy really liked that. He says, "Yeah, we'd like to." I remember him saying, "said Hey, we really like that." He said, "If you like, we'll have you come by and play that on the album." And I'm like, "Yeah, okay."
Yeah. You're like, "Sure, that sounds good. Yep."
And then it was, I kept like giving my all, and then. A week or so after that, it was like, Jimmy said, "Hey, are you doing anything for the next few months?" And I'm like, "I don't know, I don't think so." He said, you want to be in the band? And I'm like, "Yeah, okay." And that was it. Everything was like, we were so well rehearsed that it was like, everything was first or second takes. I mean, everything, the whole thing with vocals and everything. Paul Rodgers is just amazing on the vocals.
Oh,
so he was just like...
Fire and Water is still one of my favourites.
Incredible, yeah.
With Ace Frehley, we just did a cover of Fire and Water.
Oh, you did? Yeah.
Paul Stanley singing on it.
Nice. Yeah. I knew Andy Frazier as well. God bless him. I mean, just...
What a player.
What a player and a writer. I know, yeah. He was like 17 or 18 or something when they did that stuff.
Yeah.
What was it?
Crazy.
Now, you can't do that on a fret so well because you got all this. So the tuning of that, but I do it. Do it with a few harmonics. I cheat.
Everybody at the core is a big Andy Fraser fan as well as Jacko. Mm-hmm. Even though he doesn't get talked about, because when we were talking to Billy Sheehan, Mr. Big is called Mr. Big because of that song.
Mm-hmm.
How are you doing? Yeah.
But let's not fail to acknowledge the person, the bass player, who inspired, no doubt, John Deacon, John Paul Jones, and that has to be James Jameson.
James Jameson, yeah.
I mean, you have, with Jaco Pastorius and James Jameson, you have me right there. Those are my two main influences.
That's great.
John Deacon, John Paul Jones, Paul McCartney, they all had that James Jameson influence. In fact, Paul McCartney, when they were recording, they were wanting to get that. Right. That Jameson sound.
Sure.
I forget how they did it. That may have leaned the mic up against the cabinet or something to
I don't know.
They were really just wanted
trick
to get
was just
that.
One finger.
That was Jameson, yeah.
So you don't get that you just get da 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 every note.
Yeah, and it's consistent. And of course, the Fender bass at that time had the built-in mutes with the covers. You get that kind of very. Yeah. That's Jameson right there.
Yeah,
but he was doing it right here. That's the, I call that the Jameson position, but with the mute.
Yeah.
And then the Jaco position is here.
Yeah.
So.
That's great.
Bass is such a great instrument. I love it.
Oh, it's phenomenal. And you throw in the fretless and you've suddenly got like this whole world that just opens up.
Yeah, that's, I know. It's fretless just rules. Yeah.
Thanks, Tony. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
That was amazing.
My pleasure.
In about an hour there, we just got so much information. It's awesome.
We're just off on tangents and somehow came back.
A couple of limeys for the Americans that grew up listening to music in the 70s.
And I hear that some English are offended by the term limeys. I think it's hilarious.
No, not only is it hilarious, it's actually kind of a sign of, I don't want to use the wrong word here, smartness.
Right.
Because what it was is the Spanish and the French could never figure out how we were at sea for 6 months at a time because they'd all get scurvy.
Right.
And these English sailors figured out that if you took lemons and limes and you sucked on it and got the vitamin C, not that they knew that's what it was, they figured out they could stay out at sea for 6 months at a time.
So anyway, that's...
Who's going to be offended by that? Saying, "You're smart."
Adrian Vandenberg would always call me a limey teabag.
Oh, yeah, the teabag. I used to get teabag And there's another one off camera I'll tell you about.
Of course. Anyway, it's been a blast.
It's been
thanks,
wonderful.
Warren. It's been a blast. It really has.
Thanks very much. Thanks. Please subscribe. Leave loads of questions and comments below. I might even call Tony and ask a couple of things so I can give you some answers. Oh, I shouldn't have said that.
It's okay. It's fine.
So it's okay. Thank you ever so much for watching. Please subscribe. Go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list.